Hello and welcome to DDOCast episode 394, recorded on Sunday, August 9th. I'm your host, Patrick. This week's screenshot is from Michael Tang. This is something he submitted for DDOCasplat. The screenshot of the week is not out yet because we're recording this super early to fit in the schedules of the amazing panel of people we have, which we'll find out in a moment. We like to talk about Dungeons & Dragons online nearly every weekend. You can watch us through Twitch, YouTube, DDO forums, or from our website at DDOCast.com. DDOCast is hosted by Cyber Ears, the awesome podcast hosting network, and shows are usually available within a few days of recording. The next show will probably be on Saturday, August 22nd, and you can stay updated by following us on social media pages, such as at DDOCast on Twitter, or you can follow our website, DDOCast.com. We've got a calendar there. On the podcast this week, we have a debate so epic. We're going to have four panelists. We're going to talk about the really big, important things of DDO, or at least that's what I'm calling this episode, because there's not really a better thematic thread through them all. But I'm going to turn it over to our guest moderator, everyone's favorite, Lessah.
Already? Yeah. You're ready for me to drive this train wreck into oblivion?
Oh, man, do it.
All right, wow, can I jump straight to the panel introductions?
Please do.
Okay, awesome. Well, I'm your guest moderator, Lessah. I do the Damsels of DDO and the DDO Cocktail Hour, and sometimes Patrick ropes me into helping out with the DDO cast because apparently I cannot say no to him. So, without further ado, let's meet our panel. First up, our first panelist really needs no introduction. He plays on the Sarlona server, he loves DDO, gay sex, and never wants to wear pants ever.
All sex.
He's a magic player, a wannabe professional Twitcher, and a podcaster with many years of experience under his belt, always good for a laugh, whether he's
all
a fat
sex
halfling or a lady dwarf named Butterball. No, the man really needs no introduction, but he's going to get one anyway. He's Samius Gurobo.
Aren't you glad I didn't interrupt you?
You are a horrible person because you actually did interrupt me, but welcome, Samus.
Thank you.
I hope you are ready for this epic debate. I have been waiting for you and Chai to be on the same panel for a long time. So anyway, that leads me to, he hails from the Thalena server and maybe Sarlona, maybe also Arganessen, and is known as the most hated man on the DDO forums with loads and loads of infractions. He is a resident expert on many things, even if he knows nothing about it. He's a permadeather, he's a power gamer, and probably a friend of mine. His name is Chai. Welcome, Chai.
Thanks.
He didn't have anything to say first thing. He's like, thanks.
Yeah.
All right.
And he
yeah
said it sounds like he's actually genuine about that. Thank you. Like,
yeah, I know.
He's part of all of these accomplishments.
Yeah, I know. It is something to be proud of.
Most hated person on the forums.
That's right. I think he gets a title for that. Most hated or hated, something like that. We should petition for that. Go ahead. Use your power, Patrick, and make that happen. All right, next up, from the Thalena server, he is an endgame player, mostly, who has his own YouTube channel that you need to subscribe to if you haven't already. His name is Alex, and for some reason, I'm going to assume that that is his real name. Welcome, Alex.
Yeah, Alex is my real name. Axel is my name that most people know me by in the game. Yeah, I run a YouTube channel. It's one of the official fan sites, so check it out.
Yeah, I was actually watching some of your videos and hadn't realized, and I didn't realize that I was a subscriber. Until you pointed it out to me. I am so sorry about that. But now I know. Now I know. I've just never met you before. So it's nice to meet you.
Yeah, nice to meet you. Thanks for having me on the show.
No problem. Oh, thank you for being on my show.
It is your show this
week.
What?
That's right. That's right. Next up, last but not least, he's the host with the most, even if he doesn't have a soul. The bravest man to take the DDO cast baton
pants
and run far, far away with it. He's Patrick, and he wins everything. Yay!
I don't know if I actually
welcome,
won a debate
Patrick
episode, but I was going to try and interrupt Lessah, but I'm just not as good about it as Samus is. He's got the experience.
He does. He's been with me a long time.
People
almost 100
love it.
Shows, many years.
It's the favorite thing. I get the most feedback on my interrupting Lessahs. They love it. It's the best.
I thought you got... Never mind. Okay, so anyway, let's go right into our DDO debate rules. Gentlemen, I want a clean fight. Each guest will be given the opportunity to give an opening argument in rotating order. Arguments should be creative, passionate, amusing, and factual, but they should not be mean. Remember Chai and Samus.
Why am I even here?
That we do need to get this debate done by the end of the day. So your arguments should also be to the point. Is what I think I'm trying to say.
I have to be short-winded and nice. Yeah. I don't know if this is going to work.
By the end of the day.
Yeah.
Oh, it's your talk.
We don't have 4 to 6 hours to do this, all right, you two? I know how wordy both of you can be. So,
I make no promises.
No. I'm amazed that I'm not getting chastised for being wordy.
Yeah, you win everything. So counterpoints are encouraged, and interruptions are allowed at the moderator's discretion. If all guests choose to debate the same point, a troll will be chosen to argue a different point. The troll shall receive double experience points while trolling. Points will be arbitrarily awarded at my discretion, and they have no meaning, so I can give out as many as I want. The winner at the end gets nothing! Yay! If at any time the two of you wish to begin a heated makeout session due to the overflowing passion of your arguments, please don't let the moderator stop you. And for every wrong answer Patrick gives, he must remove an article of clothing. If he does this, he will win by default.
All right, I'm done. I got my clothes on.
Does everyone understand the rules?
Sure.
A couple of those I added myself. Can you guess which ones?
Well, since I added the one about the clothing, it was not that one. So I'm not sure which one you put in.
You're not sure which one I put in? All right. Well, let's just jump right in. First question. Do we need a new difficulty, and what should that difficulty be? I want you to pitch me that new difficulty, starting with Samus Gurobo.
Well, this is bad because I don't think there needs to be a new difficulty at all. I think the difficulties we have are good, they are fine, they just need fixed and adjusted correctly. The problem is, for example, you have 1, 2, and 3, but the differences between 1, 2, and 3 are not even. They just need to be evened out so they are actually 1, 2, and 3 instead of 1, 1.5, and 3. See, I can be short-winded.
Wow, I love that. Anyway, well, pitch me a new difficulty, Chai.
So I don't believe that there needs to be a new difficulty. I think the 4 difficulties that we have need to do what they actually say they do. Probably the best example of that was in 2012, right after Menace of the Underdark came out, when we had Epic Normal, Epic Hard, Epic Elite. When you went into Epic Elite, you knew that you needed to be on your A game, or you know, you were going to get wrecked. It was going to be tough. If heroics were like that, that would be fantastic, but they've gone through, 8 to 9 years of power creep now without much adjusting of the difficulty settings, which is why you see the complaints that Elite is like the default XP difficulty right now that everybody can run. Biggest complaint against that I've seen is probably, how am I going to get my favor? Because if I can't run Elite now when I used to be able to before, that might be prohibitive. But they can make adjustments to that and still make the difficulties do what they say they do, rather than having it be Elite is the default and everything underneath it is like, yeah, I run that once for XP.
I'm going to have to ask you to stop making your answers make so much sense. Alex, tell me something different.
Well, I agree with Chai that we do need an increase in difficulty, but I guess I disagree in that I don't think he wants to do it through a new difficulty. He wants to do it by making Elite harder. I think we have to go to a new difficulty at this point. We can't really make Elite harder because the developers tried that with the Monster Champions, and people really got upset. A lot of people did. So, yeah, at this point, I think we definitely have to go to a new difficulty above Elite.
Well, pitch me this new difficulty.
Well,
what's it called?
Well, if you looked at some of the threads in the forums, it might be called Reaper. Or you could call it Mythic, whatever. But I think a good idea to, well, let's utilize the Monster Champion system that we have. I don't know if this is possible because I'm not a coder, but could they not just take Elite, kind of copy and paste that, and then tweak the Monster Champion stats up, to make it more difficult, or until we get to that good ground where people do feel challenged. I know incentivizing it's kind of a problem, and that's something the developers have talked about on the forums, but how about stuff like higher named drop rates, maybe higher Mysterious Remnant drops, maybe some tome chances. I mean, heck, maybe a really small chance for an LR heart or something. Stuff like that, I think we could use to incentivize it. So that's
all
my
right.
pitch.
Wow me, Patrick.
Prepare to be wowed. So we could definitely use some added pizzazz and spice in terms of difficulty, but I'm not going to pitch a new difficulty. What I'm instead going to pitch is a mode of play. We're going to call it hardcore mode. This is something you pick at character creation. You can check a little box and say, yes, I want to play hardcore. And the only time that you can choose to be that is when you're creating a new character or when you're doing a true reincarnation. So you can't do it at lesser reincarnation, can't do it any of that kind of time. It's when you're creating a, quote, new character or a reincarnated character. And what this does is it gives you, whenever you die, you get XP debt. So just like we used to have, so every time you die, you lose some XP, which people who used to play back then know that that could stack up pretty good. In return, what you get out of this is you get plus maybe 5 or 10% XP gained from doing actual quests, not from a stone, from actual quests or challenges. And then you get a running counter, kind of like we had with Bravery Streak. But for every quest or challenge you complete, whether or not you've done it before, you get an increment on your hardcore counter. And then using that, you can get other incentives, like, say, maybe your name changes to a color to indicate that you're a hardcore player that's completed 500 quests on hardcore mode. And then later, if you choose that you don't really like doing that anymore, it's getting too much for you, you can go visit an NPC, and they'll turn it off for you. They won't turn it on, but they'll turn it off for you, and then you lose all the benefits you would get of being hardcore.
Well, they call it hardcore for a reason. No new difficulty, you say? Well, that doesn't sound like we're giving the developers enough work to me.
Hey, I'm pitching a whole new mode of playing here.
Yes, you are. So, 999 points.
Well, you don't
to chai.
They, like, debate.
Oh, wait. All right. I'm ready to give out points. I'm like, ah. That's okay. You're still going to win. All right. Yeah, go ahead. Argue.
I guess. Go ahead.
The thing that one person was, which I was saying about making elite actually elite, the problem is that there's such a normative point that players expect to be able to complete elite, at
yes.
least on heroic.
Yep.
Yes.
Right.
And that's the expectation. Problem. The area yep. there isn't that, that's, well, okay, I'll say it in a more oversimplified fashion. The error is that they allowed that to slide too long before making the adjustment. If
right.
they let it slide for 5 or 6 years and then make the adjustment, now the expectation is you have 6 years worth of players that from day one all the way up to 6 years into playing the game, that this was the expectation. I could always run elite. Now why are you taking this away from me? That's the error. However, if they redid the difficulties and maybe made hard and elite favor the same, then what's the difference? You know what I mean? If they made the adjustment where, hey, you can have your favor. You know what? I'm not going to fault anybody for wanting to get their bag slots or whatever. But elite is still elite. It actually challenges people in the now rather than, hey, this used to challenge people 7 or 8 years ago where we all had to shield wall doors and firewall and stuff like that, new strategy, where now it's just run, kill. But it doesn't challenge anybody anymore, or at least it doesn't challenge enough people where – you know, people think it's the expected thing to run. Default should not be the highest top setting in the game. And that's kind of what I'm saying. I realize that there are faults to just, you know, adding difficulty and being done with it. There would need to be adjustments made to whatever rewards are given so that people could still get their rewards. But having elite be the default is just, it's kind of getting old. I mean, who's challenged by that right now?
So I'm going to jump in here. First of all, when I read this question, I thought this was the difference between epic elite, epic hard, epic normal, because any heroics just, you know, it's that fun thing you do when you're tired of grinding out epic experience. So you run through those levels and you have a good time. That's probably my favorite part of the game, is level 1 to 20. somewhere in that 20, in that low 20s. It's probably my favorite part of the game. And it's not necessarily because I blow through the quests or whatever, because the monster champions and some of the things that they have tweaked to increase that difficulty slightly that still adds variance to the game is still worthwhile and exciting. But for the majority of people, heroic levels just don't matter.
That's the problem.
A lot of people don't go... Well, once you get to 20, a lot of people just stay there. If they do anything, they're going to epic TR. They're not going to necessarily heroic TR after 3. For example, I know Patrick is a big fan of like just doing epic stuff, along with several of my guildies. So, I mean, you're talking about reworking a system that a small percentage of the population is going to use anyway. And then you turn around and take people like my wife, who does enjoy that TRing process and does through the quests, and she does her best to do everything she can on Elite because she feels like as a player who's played for, I don't know what, 10 years, 11 years, however bloody old this game is now, that she should have the skills to handle it. And then she gets in the situations where she'll spike on the rough end of variance with the monster champions and stuff now, and she wants to throw her keyboard out the window. Which is good that there's that variance there, because then when she completes the quest, she is that much more rewarded. But the challenge is still there. It's there for everybody. I just took and we, right before we logged on, we wiped in a run of the pit, which I said, I don't think I failed a run of the pit in 6 years. So it's definitely there. It's definitely challenging. It's a matter of whether or not a particular build is going to have a problem, and different builds are going to have different problems and different quests. People are just going to skip things. The only way that you're going to be able to add this layer of challenge that I kind of think that you're mentally projecting is to force everyone to run through all the quests where all the challenges are going to have different challenges on the different classes and builds and whatnot.
See, that
which
would
that wouldn't be any fun.
That would be true if we weren't dealing with like 8 years of... I mean, think about how DDO was back, say, when 10, 12, 14 was the cap. You know, do you think it's cooler to have to actually use strategy to kill the boss at the end of STK where everybody shield walls and the one guy throws the magic missiles? Or do you think it's cooler for everybody to just rush him, club him twice, and now he's dead? You know, that kind of thing, to me, those days were when heroics were actually challenging and required some level of teamwork to get through.
On the flip nowadays, side of that, though, there was, like, if you go back to those days and you talk about, like, Vaughn 6, a lot of times you ended up with people not, or at least in my experience, some people didn't get into the raid because they couldn't heal the hero tank at the end. Because everybody, it was one guy going, the strategy was one guy went against the dragon and everyone else did some kind of healing, and if you couldn't participate in that, people wouldn't let you into the raid.
Yeah, but there's been enough power creep to that point where you don't have to have that happen anymore.
You also have the problem where
you've got enough room to play there, enough variance.
You also have the problem where you're having situations where a quest that was a large percentage of the game at the time, right? Because again, with the there was what? 100 quests? Let's just pretend there was 100 quests when the level cap was like that and people were using this strategy. So that quest was, say, a tenth of the time that you're going to be on the in the playing, right? Doing that quest took a certain percentage of time. Now there's just so many more quests, the percentage has gone down to kind of make up for the fact where all the quests are. So it kind of seems almost pointless to say there's no strategy, because there is a lot of strategy involved, but at the same time, you know, you're still allowing the same percentage of time for a quest in the overall scheme of things.
Alex, you have a nice voice. I need to hear more of it. What do you think about all of this?
Well, I think the issue is, yeah, a lot of players are challenged enough on Elite, but there is a segment of players who just, in Epics, I mean, I pug all the time with Atlantis, and I can't remember the last time a full six-man group failed an Epic League quest. Like, it's just, I don't know, it's just not that difficult for me these days. Maybe someone else has a different experience, but I know for me and the other players I play with, it's just, yeah, we just don't wipe anymore. And it's just, you know, it gets old. I want more of a challenge than we have in the game right now.
So on this scenario, we're talking about a group of people that you've got a relationship with and you know how to play with, and that team that you've cultivated doesn't play or doesn't lose very often.
No, I pug like pretty much.
Well, you just said with the group of people I play with.
Well, the people on the Atlantis server that I play with. I mean, I don't have a lot of people I meet up with regularly on a static group or anything, but it's quite a few people I play with.
But you recognize a large segment of names, and you basically, it's not really so much a pugging situation as it is a group of people that you often play with, but it's almost like pulling from that random pool of 30 guys or gals.
Well, there's probably a segment of people that say it.
All people are people, Samus. He's like the Jesus of DDO.
So
the Valenus Messiah.
So my point is, it's less of a pug after a certain period of time, anyway, and more of a straw pool of people who have a like skill and a like amount of ability. Where the problem is, you're going to have 90% of the population out there who can't handle a harder difficulty, wouldn't want to handle a difficulty, so you're basically having people spend dev time on something that's going to cater to 10% of the population.
I don't think it's 10%. I think it's a lot more than that. And it's kind of hard to get a figure of what the exact percentage is, but man, just pugging on Thalanus, I mean, I don't ever see people struggle anymore in six-man quests on Epic Elite.
I'll give you an example that I used
before. Maybe you're too busy carrying the quests with your big muscles.
No.
I'll give you the example I used before, right after Menace of the Underdark came out. When Epic Elite was like, wow, these things hit for a lot, we better figure out what we're going to do against this. Like before the whole armor up thing, which we will talk about later, that was a huge adjustment that needed to be made with, especially in Pugs. Was the grouping scene actually better or worse in that era? I feel it was better because we could play on hard and it would be challenging enough. But when we played on Elite, it was like, all right, let's have a game plan going in. So that way, you know, two people don't run one way and two people run another way or whatever.
Yeah, and that's the whole thing. We have four difficulty settings. I want them all to be utilized. I just don't like that people tend to run Elite, especially in Heroics, just by default. I mean, that's just when there's a ceiling there, the more veteran players, the more experienced players don't have anywhere to go up from there. It's great that there's a segment of players who do find Elite challenging enough, but for some players, it's just you're stuck at Elite. You can't go any higher than that. It's a little frustrating.
I think we're all kind of, I'm going to steer towards my pitch a little bit just for kicks. I think a lot of what we're talking about, though, is you're talking about a lot more dev time, getting a lot of this stuff out, whereas some of the stuff that I'm talking about, you know, the XP debt is something that was in the game for a long time. We've seen changing colors of guild names, so it seems pretty reasonable that you could change colors of player names, a little extra XP, which we've seen in a lot of varieties. What do you guys think about that kind of as a
would that be divisive to the population? Would people that are on hardcore mode only be able to play with other people in hardcore mode?
You could play with anyone you wanted to. I would not try to pitch that you couldn't. There might
so
be
if I'm a hardcore mode guy and you're not, or you're the hardcore guy and I'm not, can we play together? Can we both walk into the same class?
There's nothing preventing us game technical wise from doing that.
So
there are probably people that will choose not to.
Sure. But. So if I check the hardcore box at character creation and you didn't say, what's the difference in our gaming experience then? How do I get my hardcore mode?
You can only choose it at character creation.
Right.
And you get, if you die, you get XP debt, which is kind of the downside. But then everything else, is you can get more XP potentially, or your name changes. You get the counter that everybody wanted with Bravery Streak.
I see.
Heck, maybe you get more remnants or plus one to all your loot. I mean, there's a lot of different ways you could incentivize it with just kind of small things. But.
So where I stand on that is there's a difference between less forgiving and more difficult. I can make a game super difficult, and I can have it be super forgiving, where you can get back to where you were in 2 minutes if you croak, but the challenge is still there. Or I can make a game easy, but if you're complacent and you screw up, it can be hella unforgiving. You could be sitting in a tavern for days withering away XP debt or getting half XP for your next 15 quests every time you die, but you shouldn't have died anyway but you made a mistake, so... You know, so you're basically introducing like punitive penalties to screwing up? Is that...
That's one way of looking at it.
So,
I think my only complaint...
I see where you're going.
What Patrick is suggesting here is, I don't know that that really makes the game harder. It just kind of penalizes your mistakes more.
Yeah.
It doesn't actually make it harder, though. It just makes it less forgiving.
That's fair.
So I know Lessah has thrown a two-minute warning in here like a minute and a half ago, so I'm going to sum this up quickly. I guess my biggest problem is with the idea of adding another difficulty is how the developers kind of implement what they consider difficultness. And typically what that means is the monsters are going to hit harder, the monsters are going to have more hit points. And to me, that does not make a quest harder. It just makes a quest longer, which longer to me does not equal challenge. And now if they could somehow figure out a way to implement more technology in the sense that the monsters use different tactics or monsters coordinate better, where it does give us incentive to use more tactics, I would be more inclined to agree that that difficulty would be more appealing on a challenge basis. But right now, using the same kind of model that we already have for what the difference between difficulty is, another step up in difficulty wouldn't be any more challenge. It would just be longer.
Did you all hear that?
Yep.
I still hear
it. It's an app. It's an app. All right, good arguments, guys. Good arguments all around. XP didn't actually change. 999 XP to Chai for making solid arguments. 1,000 XP to Patrick for cruelty and bringing back the idea of XP debt, and then minus 1,001 XP for having a beard. 600 XP to Samus for thinking of the little people, and 500 XP to Alex for having a pleasant voice. IW DDO Messiah. Patrick, get on that. He needs a forum title.
Someone has an internet crush.
I thought you liked the beard.
I do. Anyway, let's get on to the next thing, and we're going to go in reverse order this time. I want to know what is the worst designed raid. Go first, Patrick.
Oh, goody. So I'm choosing Titan, and the reasons I have for this is the pre-raid quest is fairly long. It's difficult to complete. In fact, most groups don't even get a completion. They just kind of get to the end so they can go through. They skip some of the puzzles. You can't even get to the raid entrance in a raid party apart from Greater Teleport. If you don't have Greater Teleport, you have to go through probably the single most confusing explorer area in two separate six-person parties. And you have a very low margin of error. You can only miss with two of the pillars and still complete. And in the end, really, 3 to 4 people do all the work in the raid.
All right. Next, Alex.
Well, I actually really like this raid, but I'm going to have to say Demon Queen just because of the flagging mechanics, which I think are really bad. You have to go through that pre-raid, which isn't even a 12-man quest. You've got a long run out there. It's annoying to have to organize two different groups and two different LFMs, and then the first group has to wait on the second group to get done, and then you have difficulties getting someone in a pug to start a second group. And I know today it's not that difficult of a raid, but back when it was actually difficult and you needed 12-man group, it was a big headache. And I really like that raid, and it's sad it's such a kind of a headache to get started and organized.
You used to have to reflag all the quests on that one, too.
Yeah, well, at least we don't deal with that.
All right, Chai, tell me about things you hate.
I went with Titan as well. Pretty much I have bullet point for bullet point what Patrick actually said. I remember when, you know, a couple of people would go in there, start doing all of stuff that can be done with like maybe 2 or 3 people, while there would be a recruiter sitting outside waiting to teleport people or trying to get people to the quest. And many times it would take just as long to get everybody else to the actual raid as it would take to complete the actual pre-raid part and then get into the raid, where 10 people pike, one person runs crystals and the other person fires the laser. And it isn't so much the margin of error that kills it. It's that the errors can happen regarding lag, regarding the actual AI not doing what you thought it was going to do and ending up in a different spot or whatever. And that to me is like, well, we got here and now we have to default because of this. We have to do it all over again. Yeah, no thanks. So, yeah, it's probably why they haven't revamped it yet either, even though most of the other stuff has either gone epic or been revamped since then.
Okay, Samus, are you ready to troll?
Yeah, and actually I probably am, because to me the definition of a raid is basically something that you couldn't do in a six-person group, which means a lot of the raids that people consider raids to me are really, they're not. So anything that's automatically a one-room raid to me is automatically on the whole category of the worst raids. So things like Hound, VOD, technically Demon Queen,
Lord
all those
Blades.
Kind of things. Lord of Blades.
Would
well,
you
could, yeah.
Are you going to count Master Artificer and Lord of Blades? Because the raid fight is essentially
probably,
one room.
Probably. Although, like I said, to me, just if it's not something that you're journeying through together where there's different tasks, Hound to me is kind of one that's a little bit better than, say, these other ones because there is tasks inside this one room for everyone to do. To me, all of those are on the same level of bad. And then there's a lot of these quests where, like, the next level up, where the raid part really isn't actually the raid. Like, the raid place, like, when I think of the Titan raid, I think what people consider the pre-quest, where then the capstone of that is actually a six-man quest because of the way it's designed for all the same reasons you guys all poo-pooed on it. But to me, that's still better than all of the other single-room raids. So, like, I had an answer that was a specific one that I weeded down, but really, to me, all of those that are just a one-room raid where there's no task for everyone else to do are the worst.
Back when they were endgame, they were pretty much tasks for everybody to do.
I'm curious which one the one is you wheedled down to.
Yeah.
I would love to, like, have been able to tell you, but now that I'm looking at the entire list and I didn't make a note, I couldn't tell you. But, like, I was talking with my guild over these questions, and I'm like, well, this is clearly the worst one. And then as we talked about it, it was like, well, this one is also really bad for the same reasons. And that's when I kind of locked onto this idea of, for me, it's these quote-unquote raids that are really six-man quests that are the problem because they're the one room, they're one objective, there's no variance. It just kind of groups them together. So I wouldn't say there's a single worst one right now, but a classification that is the worst.
I'd say some those one-room quests, though, have a lot of stuff going on. Like Master Artificer, you've got several different phases, a timed killing with a short time to kill something else, plus the electric puzzle.
Now that I think about it, I do remember now which one I thought was the worst. And everyone, when I kind of talked about it, they said this would be the one that I thought was the worst, and now that I think about it, they're right. It's Lord of Blades. And I think the reason why I dislike the Lord of Blades is because, specifically, I get assigned the worst task because I'm the one that manages to achieve that task without a problem.
Kiting
the dogs. And then when stuff hits the fan, I'm the one that picks up that slack and takes care of that business. So that would be the reason why I specifically don't like that one. But the reason why is, again, because it's group of just junk.
I got to defend one of my favorite raids here because it's got one of the best bosses.
I was just going to say, Patrick, how do you feel that Sam's attacking your boyfriend right now?
And I agree. And I totally agree. If I was primarily built and played as a tank, then it would be a totally different experience for me, and it would probably be the best raid in the game.
It's not just
best tank raid.
It's not just a tank, though, because, you know, even the off tanks, it's a lot of times when someone's tanking, you're just kind of sitting there and all the off tanks just come up behind, like think of like Tower of Despair, you just come right up behind the boss and you just wail on him. And there's no real concern about him turning around except for stealing aggro, where Lord of the Blades, his mechanics are such that his aggro naturally shifts, he attacks people behind him at certain points in time unless the tank does certain things right. And as far as the dogs go, I mean, this is more about the design than the way that we choose to play it. The design is not necessarily intended for us to just kite them around. Now, it's what we tend to do, but, you know, there's even a way to be penalized for that, because if they're still alive, then they can buff the Lord of Blades and any other trash that's around. So there's actually an incentive not to kite them. We just tend, as players, to do that because we're lazy.
That one is probably... That and the Conjoined Abishai Devastator are probably the two that are closest to, like, regular MMO raids, where the boss actually does something other than, I'm going to stand here and hit you while you hit me. There's actually stages to it. You react to the stages. Depending upon what he does, you have to do something, etc. Some people like that a lot, and some people hate that and would rather just have, like, their regular stand down, like, basically tank and spank boss fight, like Eri Trico's part 4 of the Shroud, for instance, where he just stands there and takes his beating and then you go collect your loot. However, the most annoying thing to me is when you're not even really raiding. It's like a, almost like a 12-person quest that 2 people are in, 10 people are out, 1 person's recruiting, you still have to get 7 people, and 2 people did most of the work. And that's kind of why I went with Titan, because it's like, wow, you know, most of that work, most of those people weren't even there for that. So if we're talking about 12 people having to do something, 10 of those guys weren't even there. I had one Sork out there waiting to teleport people, and me and one other person were doing most of it.
I think the thing that with Titan compared to, say, Demon Queen, when Demon Queen came out, people were running it. I mean, there were challenges, sure, but people were running it, and when it went epic and they changed the flagging mechanics, like, people really ran it. Even when Titan came out, people didn't run it. Like, you look at every other raid in the history of the game, and even more so now with raid timers, people pounded the raids down. They didn't do that with Titan.
That seems really weird to me, because Titan was one of those raids that I did every time it came off a timer. It was one of those things, and again, different guild, different mindset, different mechanics. But it was one of those quests that we did a lot of. And again, and this is where that definition kicks in. In the way that I've said for a really long time, they should just make the 12-man group of flagging, and then you can split off into a 6-man group and do the capstone raid where the loot's at. Because that capstone quest is not designed as a raid. It isn't a raid. The 12-man part is. So, and that's kind of where, again, I think it's a question of definition of what is a raid and what is not a raid that the problem kind of goes down into.
Sure. Yeah, with Titan, I mean, you're right. 10 people are hanging on a ladder while 2 people are doing most of the work. But again, even in the raid part, the part that you're calling a raid, like 2 or 3 people can do most of that work while everybody else is being invited to the group yet.
Sure. And it's true. But it doesn't have to be that way. We just happen to do it that way because so few people run it, so few people understand how to achieve their tasks. Like, the fastest time I ever went through that was when I had 12 or 11 other people who knew what they were doing, and we could just say, split up and do the task that you're most comfortable with, and boom, everyone blew through. It took 5 minutes or 10 minutes, and it was a blast. Instead of one guy doing the entire puzzle on the inside, or 3 people doing the swim on the other side, and all this kind of work, it just...
Hell, most groups I was in skipped the swim part entirely. You never actually had to complete the pre-raid quest to go into the raid. You just had to get to the end.
I want
to
hear once more from Axel before I ring this bell, because, man, that Demon Queen really pisses me off.
Yeah, I was wanting to chime in here with Titan. I've been playing for 6-7 years. I've actually never run Titan, and... One of the reasons is, one, no one ever runs it, so it's hard to get a group. And 2, I never really saw a reason to run it. Now, I did start playing DDO probably a little later than you guys. I think I started really getting into it sometime around Vaults of the Artificers. But even just leveling up, I never had an incentive to run it. And no one really ever ran it. So I just one of those things, I just never ran it.
The only time I ever ran it was when my guild leader at the time wanted favor for it. Which, when TR came around, that was kind of a problem, because every life she had to max her favor out almost every time.
Wow.
She was just kind of like that.
There There you go. Titan Schmeiten. That's what I say. Great arguments. So many different reasons to hate the Titan. But how else are you going to fill in that monster manual, right? It's one of the ways. Who doesn't like a little tank and spank? That's what I really want to know. 1,000 points to Patrick and Chai for sharing the same argument. Unfortunately, you must also share that XP. Minus 100 points to Samus for being existential. And 1,000 points to Alex for hating the Demon Queen. I'm not biased at all.
Just for the record, don't hate Titan. I just think it's the worst designed raid.
And I don't hate Demon Queen either. I just think the flagging mechanic design.
So many levels of dislike.
If you're one of the four people to job in Titan, it is the funnest raid of all time. Just don't
for
be one
everyone
of those
else.
I actually like the pre-raid
of...
quest. I like the puzzles. And one of
tab
the,
out.
Figuring out the
two.
Red puzzle was one of the most enjoyable experiences I've ever had in the game.
Yeah, it's a raid that has the puzzles that give the challenge that is the best raid in the game, which is, of course, Abbott. But it doesn't require Mario skills.
I was surprised no one picked Abbott, actually.
Yeah,
it's the
I'm
best
bored with
raid
this subject.
In the game.
So we're going to move on. Right. I want you guys now to become developers, and you're going to wow me. What do you want to see for a new raid? So pitch me this new raid, and we are going to start with Alex.
Okay. Now, I want to see more mechanics in raids that require you to work as a team. One of the things I don't really like about the new raid is that it's kind of just a DPS fest. You don't there's no healing role or crowd control role or tanking role. I want to see that, all those roles into a raid. Now, I don't want us to get to the point in regular quests where roles are required, but when we're talking about a raid, which is, to me, is a group experience, I want to see those roles involved in it. I also want to see puzzles, and not puzzles like the Deathworm puzzles, where really only a couple people can do it, and everyone else is just sitting there piking. I want to see puzzles like the Shroud puzzles, which I really like, because everyone gets their own individual puzzle, so everyone has something to do. So, yeah. That's it.
Job for everyone. Yep. All right, Patrick, sell me something.
I want a Tarrasque, damn it. I want the biggest, baddest monster there is, at least in 3.5. I want a Tarrasque marching on Stormreach. So what I'm thinking here is that the Army of Droam has recognized that Stormreach, which they want to conquer, is now home to huge contingents of super powerful adventurers. So they have conspired to unleash the Tarrasque. I'm envisioning this being in the Cerulean Hills. The Tarrasque is marching on Stormreach, and you are part of a hastily constructed defense. You have to defeat the Tarrasque before he breaches the gate. Maybe there's some magic behind the gate. Maybe there's some ballistas around, and then the forces of Droam will arrive to pester you to try and aid the Tarrasque, but the Tarrasque is just as likely to eat them as it is to you. Kind of like the Warlock confusion.
Sounds fun. All right, Samus, pitch me something that doesn't wear pants.
Well, I've pitched a raid for as long as I've been vocal on DDOCast, and we've done it on the forums, I've done it on our show, and I think they made it into a quest. And I'm talking about, I think it's called Precious Cargo, that last quest in the Three Barrel Cove saga. So essentially imagine that, except with flying dinghies, you send groups off to actually attack the enemy airships to prevent your ship taking damage. Some extra objectives, probably a flying dragon fight. But
maybe working
very
airship
similar,
combat?
Exactly. Very, very similar concepts, but basically the core idea of what that quest is. I said, and I've pitched that, it seems like for ages, as a possibility, and then with the possibility of landing and storming a castle on a mountain that you can only access by airship, which if you can't get your airship there, you can't achieve it. So, but basically it comes down to the course concepts of different options for everyone to do different things. So different ability to divide up into subgroups, be that puzzles, be that individual tasks like chasing dogs or dividing up melee bosses or whatever. Things that need to be done together and well-coordinated, again, like pulling letters at the same time or an underwater puzzle kind of scenario, and yet it still has moments where everyone comes together to defeat a common goal. And, of course, being more than one instance or one room. I want you to tell me a story while we're doing the raid.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Chai, tell me something that isn't going to make me hate you.
I'm actually amazed at how much mine has in common with Patrick's yet again. only instead of using the Tarrasque, I used the Kraken. The pirates basically being the ones who understand that there's oodles and oodles of treasure and loot that can be had in Stormreach. They're the ones that convince their god or goddess, whoever the Umberly equivalent is in Eberron, to manifest this insanely huge being in the middle of the ocean to just come in and start just demolishing the city. And you basically have to defend the city, and they can use different zones like the harbor and the marketplace and all of the houses as one big zone with openings there rather than like loaders. And each house will have a separate objective, and whichever objectives you achieve, those are the ones you get loot from, and the loot is going to correspond to whatever house that is. So if you completed House D's objective, you're going to get like tank style weaponry, heavy armor, stuff like that. If you accomplish House P's objective, you're going to get more along the lines of Bard and Rogue and maybe some caster loot, so on and so forth. So that's kind of what I had as far as, you know, the actual monster. There can be a whole bunch of trash mobs that come in, like an army. You have military members that you're coordinating with as far as NPCs. There's ballistas and cannons and things of that nature. And everybody would definitely have roles and things that they have to do other than DPS away and don't die. So that's kind of my take on what I would put in.
All right, sounds like almost everyone has a raid boss except Alex. I mean, Axel. Sorry.
Whichever one works. No, I've actually pitched the Kraken idea of a raid on the forums as well. When Three Barrel Cove hit, I was really open for a Kraken raid. We didn't get it. I still argue for it in the forums. Maybe we'll get lucky one day and they'll add it in.
Aren't the Krakens, though, kind of sea-bound?
I'm not sure. I could see a raid where, in Theoretical Cove, where we're running ship to ship, something sunny. You maybe could have the Kraken as a stationary boss at the end in the water.
I'm just scared of if it's a Kraken that we're going to be going to underwater fighting again.
Nah. See, the army would attack the different houses. And whoever you were able to help was basically the chest that you would end up with.
Well, so you can only help one house?
No. But whoever you failed on isn't going to give you loot.
Could you do all the objectives in the raid, or would you have to only go for one path?
You could do all the objectives, yes.
Okay. If not, I could just imagine people complaining, all the casters wanting to do the caster portion, or all the melee wanting to do whichever objective gave them melee loot.
I wouldn't try to divide people up like that. Yeah. I would basically just put the list of objectives up there and have everybody needing to work as a team. But if the army was able to get to House P and ransack and demolish it, for instance, then House P isn't going to give you their chest.
I think it's kind of interesting how we kind of all pitch things that were kind of like, like I'm pitching a raid boss. And, you know, here's the thing for me is, The Lord of the Braids is great, but it's kind of like that significant other that you've been with too long and you really need to break up with, but you don't want to break up with them until you have something better.
I think it's a matter of the fact that we all kind of latched onto the core concepts of what I was like pitching as what is an actual raid and stayed instinctively away from the things that we would define as not a raid. Nobody said, let's have a one-room thing where we're all just going to beat down the same boss.
I kind of did, and then I said the Cerulean Hills, but it's kind of a big area.
But then again, you wanted something that is dynamic with multiple roles to do and everyone can fill in, but not forced, hammered into those roles.
And a huge boss. And come on, I just want a Tarrasque. I'll be honest. I want to see the Tarrasque in the game. Partly because I want to see the developers actually... I want to see
destroy the world.
Well, I want to see the developer's interpretation of a Tarrasque.
We released the Trask, it ate the servers, game's closed. Sorry, guys.
I think that's it.
I think one of the cool things about DDO is almost always what is they do a really good job of it is seeing how the devs interpret different monsters. I think the like dragons now are really, really kind of interesting and cool depiction of how the dragons work. The Warforged Titans are pretty slick. I'd like to see their interpretation of a Trask. And plus, I think it'd just be hilarious to watch some caster cast some magic missile at it and have a rebound on him.
All right, I'm done here. Oh, unless somebody else had one more thing.
No, I was just going to say it seems like a Trask is unlikely to make it. It just seems like it's something that they would have so much difficulty doing right and doing well. It would just be one of those things that they flopped on so bad that we would just feel disappointed, like the Titan Raid, and we just wouldn't do it.
Optimism, not pessimism. All right, let's award some XP.
Mix the dragon and the Titan.
Realism. Realism.
All right, Axel, minus 100 XP because you didn't give me a boss the first time around.
Aww.
And Patrick, 500 points for pitching me an actual story. Samus, 200 XP for talking about pirates. In fact, everyone take 200 extra XP for mentioning pirates or Three Barrel Cove. And Chai gets 500 XP for using existing terrain. What the hell is this Kraken going to look like is what I want to know. I love the idea of attacking Stormreach. Heck yeah, let's break everything. So, let's move on. Our classes. The next thing we're going to talk about. Our classes balanced with each other in the game. What class is overperforming? What class is underperforming? And I'm going to tell you right now, the first person that says Paladin, I'm going to kick you off this call.
Just for
I'm
the
kidding.
Record, this
I'm kidding.
Is a...
I'm kidding. I'm fair and impartial.
This question came from Paladin. Dream on Galanda.
That's it. You're gone. Minus a million XP for mentioning Paladins. All right. Let's go in reverse order from last time. So let's start with Chai.
The classes that are overperforming compared to the game is the ones that have already been revamped recently, which includes but is not limited to Paladin. That being said, the ones that are underperforming compared to the game are none, because the game can be played as far, you know, regardless of what class you want to play, to basically play what you like. As far as compared to each other, I'd probably see Ranger needs a little love. Probably casters need some more single target DPS without having to blow their entire mana to just get a mob like three quarters of the way down, like a boss mob, and then not be able to do anything unless they drink pots. But it all hinges on, you know, what has been revamped recently. Just about everything that has is overperforming as far as the game is concerned. And it is going to be overpowered until the thing that is underpowered gets its revamp and joins the club, essentially.
So your over is what now?
Anything
your
that
under is Rangers.
So okay. Yes, Rangers probably need a little love. Yeah, you can make an archer that does Fury Shot, but if I wanted to make a Tempest Ranger right now, they probably need some. You know, if you compare them to things that have already been revamped, they need some work. Casters, single target DPS, probably need some work. They're in a good place as far as DC, except for the really most recent content. Some of that can be adjusted, but 95% of the game, they're still doing fairly well. They just need some love, single target.
All right, Samus, let's hear from you. What's overpowered and what needs work?
One of the things that I've also kind of mentioned, that the way I look at things is balanced over the lifespan of play and the lifespan over what's going on. I don't necessarily take a screenshot or write this second and say this is where the balance is at, because things are going to wax and wane. It was like that in original pen and paper. It was like that in DDO. It's going to be like it in whatever the next game is, because there's an inherent balance in imbalance when it comes to games like DDO specific or D&D and DDO specifically, based off of what level you are, what's currently being retweaked, et cetera, et cetera. So in that mindset, I feel like right now, this is probably the most balanced this game has ever been at the moment. Things that didn't have any love for years and years and years, like bards and paladins and barbarians, are now finally at a place where they got their moment in the light to shine. So it's kind of, you know, tipping the scale back that direction. So I don't feel like anything's out of balance terribly far. That being said, I don't know if there's a class that I say is overperforming. I think I would probably point to a thing that's overperforming, and that's Shiradi stuff. And I think the reason for that is, again, how my normal playstyle is. The fact that I haven't played a spellcaster for a real spellcaster for like a year, year and a half, kind of tells you what Shiradi did to the game, in my opinion. It just kind of took all the excitement out of being a wizard or being a caster of some sort. So I think, in my opinion, that is probably the primary problem. But if I were to give that a class, I would say something, one of the blaster casters. That being said, the class that is underperforming, and I will, before I give the answer, I will say, yes, Patrick, I listened to last week's episode, and you guys are both wrong, very, very wrong. DC spellcasting is dead. And again, it comes down to that percentage of expectation of working. And if something is at 50% working, that is not right. Imagine if your sword, even though you hit and make contact, just 50% of the time didn't do damage. That would have melees up in arms. It is shenanigans. Whether or not something saves is a different story. But the fact that it just doesn't work for whatever reason, if I debuff 6 times and a monster still passes 10 times in a row, that is shenanigans. DC spellcasting is dead, whatever class that you're playing.
That's the problem with binary pass-fail conditions.
Yeah, they're so hard to balance.
They're either going to be overpowered on one end or just suck to the point where nobody wants to play them on the other.
All right, Patrick, you have waited your entire life for this argument. Go.
I have wasted my life. So I think classes are in pretty good shape, and I think the thing that people oftentimes forget about when they're talking about class balance is one of the great things about D&D is certain classes have abilities that other classes just don't have, and that kind of introduces it kind of its own balance. Now, one of the things that we're running into in the game right now is healers are less desired from the standpoint that everyone has, generally at least in Epics, has some mode of self-healing. But I don't think that makes them underperforming, and it just makes them less utilized, because if you want a healer, you can make a really good healer and make it really good at that. I think the place where we lose some of the balance is, I think Chai is kind of on the right track with some of the stuff that hasn't gotten a pass yet, but I think where it really stands out is in terms of survivability for monks and rangers and kind of the light armored crowd with the PR changes. I think those builds really kind of fell behind and get pretty well plastered still. I know I've particularly like melee monks. I pulled a guy off the shelf in full disclosure, I mean, this is a character I haven't played since Motu landed. And he just gets pummeled. Now he doesn't have Destiny, he doesn't have gear and all that stuff, but I think at the same time, it shows pretty well that in and of itself, the monk class, particularly in melee, has fallen pretty significantly behind just in terms of survivability. They just can't generate PRR that everyone else can. I mean, you've even seen casters running around in heavy armor. Monks can't wear armor at all. Or they lose, like, their entire reason for being a monk. So there's a lot of issues there.
All right, Axel, are you ready?
Oh, yes. All right.
Do it.
The two classes are, like Chai said, the recently updated classes, like Paladin and Barbarian, I think are definitely overperforming stuff like Holy Sword and the Ravager self-healing. I mean, the developers have even said on the forums that they're overperforming, so it's not just my opinion. And as far as the classes that are underperforming, I'd have to say Favored Souls would be my first one, because they don't have any SLAs. They're hurt a lot by not having access to the Divine Disciple tree. And then Fighters, it's not so much that Fighters are bad, because they do have access to the Vanguard tree, which is good, but I just don't see any reason to play a Fighter over a Paladin right now. But they have all these extra feats they get, but there's really not anything to use them on. So,
how do the rest of you feel about all this?
I mean, other than the fact that, again, if we're looking at the timeline of the game, you know, because pajama-wearing super guys were in power for so long, right? Now that the shift to these heavy armor guys is in effect, it's balancing the scale in a direction that you're not necessarily seeing. The same kind of thing with the Favored Soul right now. I just did a Favored Soul life, and it was probably my favorite melee life in a very, very long time. And I've had high DPS lives, and I've had melee DPS lives. But this Favored Soul one kind of combined all the things I was looking for at the time. Again, mostly soloing on Epic Elite, 2 cap for the most part. And it got me there. It wasn't necessarily the fastest thing in the world, but I was able to do anything I wanted for the most part, with certain exceptions here or there. And everything seems to gotten done, as it were. Again, looking at the overall timeline of the game, casters, they had their time in the sun. Melees had their times in the sun. Pajamas, their time. Now it's the time of the heavy-wearing people. I think it's just a matter of looking at where the balance is tipping for you.
I would say overall, the thing that we didn't really touch on, I think the thing that for me is most important, because I'm playing a game, are the classes fun? And I think everyone kind of is aware of the fact that other than Warlock, I have one of every class at this point. I'm working on getting to a Warlock. I just haven't gotten the character to that point yet. It's the character I just bought it off the shelf that needs to actually be able to reincarnate. And I think all the classes are fun, and they all... particularly the way that I've kind of made my characters and kind of tried to specialize in what those classes tend to be good at anyways, all of my classes, all of my characters are fun to play. So I think in that sense, the classes are pretty well balanced with each other in the game.
And cricket times. Lessah?
You guys are doing a lot of... Oh, are you ready to hear my snotty comments? Because I'm ready to give them. Oh, my goodness. Chai, you are dead to me. Zero XP. I'm not sure how you sleep at night. Samus, 1,000 XP for being diplomatic. And Patrick, 1,000 XP for not mentioning paladins. Axel, you are also dead to me. Zero XP. And I'm penalizing you, your new forums title. And from now on, the only class you're allowed to roll in the character creation screen is Fighter. So, let's move on, people. Next, are monster champions good for the game? Are they working? Let's go with Patrick first.
I would say they are good for the game in the sense that I appreciate the extra little spice and randomness they give to quests, which it was kind of a design goal, so I'd say that part was working. I don't think they are as big of a roadblock as they were intended to be, but I feel like they're an appropriate challenge in the game. My only thing with it is I think the rate of acquiring remnants to what you can buy and how much that costs, I think that ratio is pretty well off.
What? Axel! What do you think?
I do think that they're good for the game, but I can't say that they're working. The problem for me is, like, I loved the Monster Champions the first. I think it was like 3 days before they got changed. But after that, they nerfed them really hard. And right now, I feel like we're at a place where no part of the player base is really happy with them, because the power gamer types, they aren't getting the challenge they want from the champions. And then you have the kind of the casual players, the XP grindy players who never really liked them in the first place. So I kind of feel that with the nerfs they put on the monster champions, they're not making anyone happy right now. So I hope to see them, you know, get addressed in the future.
Okay. Chai, do you have an argument for this?
I like monster champions. I thought they were a great idea. Some people think they were poorly implemented. I think the nerf was poorly implemented, but the first time they hit the game, they were great. The reason for that is because of the random spike damage and the random spike defenses where you needed to try something else. Because they had specific DRR or something, or DR or something like that. I think it's an incomplete system, and if they could randomize more things about quests, that would be better than just adding hit points and adding damage dealt even more, however. So in approaching difficulty in the future, instead of defining that as, well, we'll just give them more hit points and make them hit harder, they can make the quest have random traps or other randomized things that happen where it isn't always the same each time you run through. An attempt was made on that in Temple of Elemental Evil. I thought it was the parts that they did were well done, but that was also incomplete. There were some things that, you know, they could add more randomization there. But as far as the champions are concerned, I think it was sorely needed, as it made people have to pay attention to each mob again rather than just, you know, running and cleaving, so to speak.
All right. Samus, tell me you have something to say about this.
Of course I do. And we've talked about it numerous times on this show, so I don't want to get too lengthy. But first of all, I do want to say I wish we would have asked this question at the start of the show before my wife got back home from running her errand, because I'm pretty sure you're going to get me killed. Because she hates the monster champions with a fire-burning passion, and I feel like they provide the service that DDO in particular was starting to miss, and that's the spike of variance. Pretty much everybody has said, yeah, I really liked how they added that little extra spice, and I liked how they were at the beginning when it was so much tougher. And then now that they're not quite as spiky, I don't like them as much. And I've really started getting into specifically game design and how things kind of work out. And humans inevitably love variance. It's what makes a game good. And what was going on was we were getting to this scenario where we were used to the game. We were getting to the point where we could almost run the quest blindfold. You and I, Lessah, we ran several quests together, and we were shocked at how well we understood how the game was going to work, even though we played in completely different styles. And it's just because we understand the game so much. So adding in that variance is what really spiced the game up. And I think that's going to give longevity to the game. Are they working? I think for the most part, yes. But there are going to be a large portion of the population who don't like how spiky the variance is. Now, for those people, they would like to be able to have an option to just turn them off. They want to continue doing the game at the highest level of challenge, but they don't like the random spikiness of variance. And for those people, they would like to be able to turn off monster champions. And I think the problem with that is that in that regard, they're not working. They're not covering the correct amount of variance for all players at all times. And that's something that's going to be incredibly difficult to fine-tune and figure out, because most of us on this cast right now, I would consider veteran players that are very, very confident in the skills and abilities of the people they play with. On the other hand, a lot of people are going to have problems with these champions are just going to come out of the blue and destroy them, and they're going to be like, WTF, mate, what just happened? And they're not going to learn what they need to learn from the encounter with the champions. And in that regard, they're not working at all.
Sounds kind of like my first permadeath character's experience.
I mean, permadeath in and of itself is a whole new lesson in encountering with the game and figuring out how to deal with these random spikes that you're normally used to avoiding through. You take and you sprinkle in the champions for people who are not ready for that spike, and you're just gonna destroy them.
Well, I mean, you can always run hard. I mean, you can always move down difficulty.
I don't think that's necessarily
a bad thing.
You could always play with one hand tied behind your back if you want a greater challenge for the game.
You can't make
everybody
happy.
But
you can't challenge
that's what
them.
I'm saying. Properly done variants hits all aspects of all players to some degree in a reasonably positive manner. It's like when you shuffle a deck of cards, there's going to be a chance that you're going to get a royal flush in poker, and there's going to be a chance that you're going to get two pair. And that variance is very, very good, and it's very satisfying for people when it hits. The problem is that the Monster Champions, for a lot of people, are just never hitting. It is just ruining the fun for them. So in that regard, it's not working. How you adjust that, it's very, very difficult. And I think you should probably put some sort of option in the player for the player base to turn it on as they need it. Maybe with, like, you step back the XP behind the screen a little bit, and then have, like, maybe multiple tiers that you're willing to accept a Monster Champions. Like, you have no Monster Champions where they're at now, and then a souped-up version of Monster Champions, and increase the quest level, like, 0 extra XP, 5% extra XP, 10% extra XP.
That fits in with those lines. The difficulty system that we were talking about. You
sure.
could have champions at all difficulties.
Without having to tweak the difficulty of the individual quest, but just tweaking how much, to what degree these champions spawn into what levels.
Yes. And then somebody could choose hard, knowing that the variance wouldn't be as much as if they chose elite, for instance.
And see, and I'm not, I wouldn't put it there. I wouldn't put it at the level selection. I would put it at in the character options. Because, again, just because you don't want to have that extra spike in variance doesn't mean you can't or you don't want to do the quest at the highest possible level of challenge minus this variance spike. So, I don't think I'd put it there. I think I'd put it in individual toggle and then set it to the highest setting of the group at the time when the quest is kind of gone through. So, say, like, my wife, for example, who doesn't like Monster Champions, would set them for 0. I, on the other hand, do like Monster Champions, and I would set it probably at the highest setting. So then when the two of us are dueling and we run into a Monster Champion, she will know to run away, and I will know to be ready to have her save me. Now she's smiling. Okay, I think I saved myself. I'm not going to get murdered.
I was going to say, nicely done.
Anybody else got a closing argument? Before I ring this bell.
My only real issue with the Monster Champion system as it stands, I did kind of like it better initially. But my only real complaint is the remnant ratio. Specifically, I kind of like to see remnants. You know, I see a remnant on the ground, and I'm like, ooh, hey, remnant. You know, it's a fun little moment, and I'd like to have that moment more often, even if the numbers were slightly less.
I think the remnant thing is an entirely different question, an entirely different topic.
Fair point.
And basically, should be considering them a bonus to the champions and not something that goes along with the champions. It's like a gift with purchase that you didn't know you wanted.
Right on, right on. Wow, that wasn't supposed to ring quite that long. Anyway, great arguments all around. Everyone take 500 XP for your wonderful points of view. Champions are champions for a reason, right? Except Axel, take an additional 500 points of XP for saying that you can't make everyone happy.
AKA, Les has got a crush on you already. Thank you.
No, I took his forums title away. Did you hear it?
Uh-huh. I'm sure he'll get it back by the end.
We'll see.
I'm
we'll
sure
see.
He'll
it's
get
work two hard.
Back in the end if he's not careful.
So anyway, let's move on to what game system needs to be revisited and or expanded. What? Patrick, let's start with you, because I'm not even sure what this question means.
Well, there's lots of different game systems, so this one is specifically looking at, you know, what do we want to see get some change or get expanded? And the one that I chose is Guild Airships. And the reason why I picked Guild Airships is because really want to see, there's empty spaces in the ships. It's kind of just asking to get revisited. Like, we kind of just need something there. Because otherwise, what's the point of having that empty space? We want to be able to fill it. I think having to make some choices, even for the upper levels of play, would be good. So I want to see something like that. And, you know, just see some other things that you have, some other amenities, maybe some stuff that might be appropriate for, say, permadeath, or some stuff that's a little bit more of a plat sync, just to kind of give some of those options.
Who doesn't want to cause more server lag? All right, Axel, wow me.
Well, I would have to say Cane of Crafting, it's not something I ever use much myself, but people really like it. I know a lot of people in-game who really hate that it kind of loses its usefulness after, what, level 20 or so. So, yeah, definitely Cane of Crafting.
Okay, Chai, what do you think?
I would say crafting in general, including but not limited to Cane of Crafting. It seems to me that there's a number of systems that have been just completely abandoned. The collectible system that, you know, a lot of people don't even use it anymore because they know most of the stuff that they're going to get is going to be stuff that they can just buy with platinum for the most part. They have added some rewards, which can't. But then Cane of Crafting, you know, the skills go up to like plus 13. You know, our characters are going to be level 30 pretty soon. They're level 28 now. Once that loot system was changed, that Cane of Crafting thing kind of went down the tubes. Some of the ingredients, I think, could be used in multiple crafting systems. They did start doing that in Cane of Crafting, where if you want to make an Evil Outsider Bane weapon, you have to have a Devil Scale or something like that from the Shroud. But they can include, you know, more ingredients from different places to have effects that are similar to the effects from those places. And I think it would be cool to be able to make cosmetics as well. So if I take my armor and I want to dye it all black and, you know, everything that you can see on my character, or if I wanted to, you know, take be able to customize like the pauldrons on my character because one of them is huge and one of them is small or something like that. I should be able to do that in a similar type of Cane of Crafting where, yeah, I like the stats on this armor, but it should be this. I know we're kind of overlapping with glamoring, but not really because I'm talking about like kind of different things like either altering one detail or being able to alter the colors that, you know, people wear. So this would definitely, it would hit all play styles. It would hit the power gamers because if you were going to, say, you had a gear set, you had two slots left and you absolutely needed different, like, say, four effects and you need to fill two gear slots. Well, you could just craft two items that give you those four effects. It would hit the casual player because the casual player doesn't necessarily need to run raids to get specific DR breaker. They can just make it. It would hit the people that like cosmetics because those people could make their characters look the way that they want them to look. So I think it would also provide something for everybody in the game and not just cater to like one play style or whatever.
All right, make it rain up in here. All right, Samus, you're next.
First of all, I want to say I like everybody else's stuff before. I do think Cane of Crafting needs a lot of work, but I feel like that's the easy thing to say. I do feel that airships could use some love. We've talked about a lot of that stuff on the different podcasts before. Pets, trophies, stuff like that. I think that's all well and good. But I think we need to expand specifically guild rewards. And I want to zoom in specifically on guild augmentations. It was a feature that got a lot of love in its time, but had a lot of issues. And I think that was just because of the... I'm going to blame the individual dev because I don't believe he works there anymore, and he can lick my balls. So Solar, you can eat one. But specifically, his idea, why terribly, terribly flawed, was very good, of having the ability to tie stuff like augments specifically to your current guild level. The way things are done right now, you know, once you work up to a certain point, you unlock certain features, you fall back down, who cares, you've already unlocked it, it doesn't matter. where with guild augments, for example, that fluctuates up and down, back and forth, left and right, so with your guild level. So if you were to revise how the guild augments work that actually scales up and down, that could really give you a reason to be in a top-tier guild besides you've unlocked everything. Once you unlocked everything, it just becomes an e-peen of, what color am I? Is my guild name? What color is it? Where instead you could put these features in there that are actually useful and valuable depending on what you're doing. And then you could take and do things that, something that I've always wanted it to do is I want to be able to go someplace on my airship that I have unlocked or as a scale, put my cool thing in, put down a, pull a little lever, it goes, makes a cool little noise, and now my thing has an augment slot on it. But I want to have a wider range of augments. The augments that we have right now of the different colors are fine. They're good. They're okay. But think about how much more better. Yes, I said more better, folks. More better that they could be if they were tied to something like your guild level. Especially something that maybe scales with the guild level. That would be incredibly powerful, incredibly fun, and very, very flavorful.
Would it kind of force everyone to be in a high-level guild, though?
No, because it's just a reward for someone who's already in a high, or somebody that's in a high-level guild that doesn't penalize you for not having something. There's a concept out there that because somebody doesn't have something and somebody else does, there's punishing you for not having it. That's not true. It just gives you something to strive for and something to work for.
So I'm going to pitch one more thing with the guild airships. Imagine having a room that was basically like a locker room of airship paint. That whenever you bought paint for your airship, it went in there and you could reapply it whenever you wanted to. So you didn't have to like rebuy for the new paint style.
Well, then how is the Lessah going to keep the turbine store open?
There's other things that she can buy.
Lessa's got to change paint schemes based off of whatever
the
flows
seasons.
Are fancy.
Patrick, are you pandering to me right now because it's working every drop?
If you think that's pandering, wait till later.
Yeah, I really like what Patrick said about the airships because. Man, they spent all that developer time on all that beautiful artwork down there, and there's just not much of a reason to go down there. It would be really cool if there's more stuff to do, more reasons to actually go on the lower levels of the airships. It would be cool if they put, like, how about some mini games or something? Like, there's some puzzles down there, stuff like that to just hang out as a social thing.
Heck,
and do.
Shroud puzzle, just to try, like, a practice room for the Shroud puzzle or the Reaver puzzle could be kind of fun.
My wife's giving me a look, and I'm winking at her because I'm thinking how you guys are talking about things that I've all summed up in the past about things that need to be improved with airships and guilds. And I'm glad that somebody else is pimping them instead of me. But I think if you want to make guilds and high-level guilds and various level guilds more popular, you put in something like an augmentation system that runs off a guild level. Maybe there's a really, really powerful... Maybe there's a very, very powerful effect that you can only get if your guild level is between 20 and 40, right? But, so, depending on what you're doing, and maybe it powers through your guild or something, and it helps, like, generate renown, or perhaps, you know, it gives bonus XP to people who are playing together. There's some sort of powerful effect that happens at this level range, and then that's an augment slot of some sort, or an item slot of some sort, and then, but it's no longer worthwhile once you're like in the 100 range, where instead you could get something that says like, on critical hits, this does an extra 1d2 points of damage per level of your guild, or an extra d4 per level of your guild, and then that becomes an extremely powerful effect. So it gives you it goes exactly to what level your guild is at the current time to help you focus on working that up or working that down or whatever your motivation is to where you want to be. Maybe you want to let your guild renown creep down to a certain level range. Maybe you want to keep it up. It gives the guild an overall project and gets the guild working on something together besides just advancing forward.
All right. I'm done here. Let's award some XP. Patrick, 500 XP for wanting to pimp out my airship even more and take an additional 1,000 XP because you want to give me a storage closet for paint. Axel, 500 XP for wanting to give Keeneth Crafting some love. Hey, maybe you'll use it if they do that. And Chai, minus 500 XP because I remembered how you like to destroy collectibles in front of me. Plus, but give yourself 1,000 XP for talking about dying armor. Really good. Samus, 100 XP for mentioning your balls, 100 XP for saying in a sentence, and another 100 XP for saying up and the up and down reference in a sentence where it was an innuendo. Good job. Good job, everyone.
It was definitely an innuendo.
Good job. All right, so let's move on to the next thing because we are running tight on time. Because I think this is going to be one that you guys are going to argue about a little bit. Did the armor up PRR MMR changes go too far, and are they good? I think it is time for us to start with Axel.
Yes, I think they did go too far. The problem is heavy armor, just you get all of that PRR and MRR just from equipping it, whereas evasion, you have to invest in a high reflex save. And the big thing that really kills you, if we're talking like epic elite stuff, is spike damage. And heavy armor smooths out that spike damage, whereas a cloth-wearing evasion build, yeah, you're going to have a high dodge and such, and you can avoid a lot of it, but you're still going to take those big spikes that you wouldn't otherwise take with the heavy armor. So yeah, I think it did go too far, and there's not enough incentives to wear robes and light armor as opposed to heavy armor. Because even casters can take enhancements to reduce their arcane spell failure and wear heavy armor at this point.
Okay, I am so ready for Chai's argument.
PRR is great. MRR went too far. And the reason why I say that is because if we didn't have MRR in the game, you'd have a pretty clear dichotomy between the plate wearer who can mitigate the physical damage better but has to worry about spike damage from casters versus the evasion person who takes those spike damage from melee and gets killed in one shot but can mitigate caster damage better. Right now, throwing on full plate and having a tower shield, I can mitigate physical damage better than the evasion person, and I can mitigate magical damage good enough where it doesn't spike so high that it's not going to kill me, and I can just recover from that with self-healing, and I don't have to worry about it too much. So the person that really gets the shaft here is the monk or the rogue, possibly, who can only wear light, or the monk who can't wear any armor because their PRR is going to be lower. But there's no trade-off for putting on the plate, where if we didn't have MRR, that would be the trade-off. You'd be weaker to casters, but you'd still get your physical damage mitigation. So that's probably where they should have gone with it. And realistically, that would probably be more balanced.
Okay, Samus, are you ready to come in with this?
Yeah, sure. I guess, first of all, I would say the changes are probably fine as they are right now. Do I believe they're going to get tweaked in the future? Probably. Again, the way I look at the game is a matter of time, right? So back in the not-too-distant Wayback Machine, armor class was a joke. You either just slapped on whatever you possibly could and been happy with your 25% chance to not get hit by damage, or you go to the Wayback Machine, and people didn't bother because it took more effort for it to be effective than they were willing to give. So this kind of change is shifting to Tobrell had the really good word for it yesterday when we were talking. I think he said sponge system, where it's essentially absorbing certain percentage of the damage, is really good, and it really gives the classes, like paladins, potentially barbarians, even though they normally aren't somebody like that, the favorite soul, the cleric, it really gives them an opportunity to step up with their defenses in a way that's actually meaningful and gives them a real opportunity to shine. So I like it. However, I dislike certain features. For example, like I said, I did my favorite soul life a few weeks ago, and I hit level 25, and I was going to upgrade to my Black Dragon set. And I wasn't really paying attention, and I wear a cosmetic armor skin all the time now, And I just equipped the Black Dragon, the Epic Dragon armor, and the Epic Dragon hat. And I went to do Epic a Giant Hold quest with Tobrell, because I had sold them all a couple days before to get to 25, and he wanted to run through them again. And all of a sudden, I was really struggling in the quest to keep up and to not struggle. In fact, I believe I died. And I was like, this is so crazy to me, because I walked through this quest yesterday without any problems. And for some reason, I took my cosmetic armor off. I don't remember exactly why. And I realized I was wearing my Black Dragon robe, not Black Dragon plate, where the day before when I had upgraded, I was wearing the Dragon Touched plate. And that dawned on me, and so I went and I swapped back, and it was such an incredibly powerful difference to go from literally the Black Dragon robes to the Black Dragon plate, that it skewed the way that I was playing to such a degree that I didn't realize how effective the PRR was. So I do like that. Les is going to stop typing.
I need to stop. All right, I need to get up. We need to move on to Patrick. So you guys can argue out about it here in a second. Go, Patrick.
I think the changes were good. I think maybe they went a little too far with the heavy kind of group. But I think where the biggest disparity is again, it's been mentioned before, is that the lighter armored folks got left behind a little bit too much, particularly monks. And maybe we'll see some catch-up in the when they redo their trees and stuff. But the only way for a monk to really inherently get PRR just as a monk is to go into Earth Stance. And even then, you have to invest into either the Shintao and or Grandmaster tree. But other than that, it's really hard for them to get much of anything in terms of PRR. And when you're talking about a heavy tank being able to get up to, you know, over 100 to 200 PRR compared to a monk that is struggling to get just to, like, 30 to 40 PRR, that's a huge disparity in between the two that wasn't there before.
Are we ready to argue?
Yeah, you guys need to start fighting immediately.
So the disbalance, or the perceived unfairness of the monk not having as much PRR compared to the fighter right now is the fighter is giving up dodge chance. And dodge is the actual real armor class of DDO right now. So while the monk is giving up absorbing the blows, they're not taking the blows to start with. It's all a trade-off. As well as the fact that a year ago, you would laugh if someone tried to show up as a heavy armored tank to try to tank your raid, where you would take the pajama-wearing monk tank instead. It's just, it's time to shine.
But here's the thing, if you're the pajama guy, you know, okay, let's say you can get your dodge up to 25%, just as an example, because the math is easy. If two hits kill you, you know...
Don't take two hits in a row.
In four swings. Well, but the math says that, you know, if you get hit... And some of the stuff has double strike that you're facing. You know, it sure swings once and you get hit four times. The math says you're dead.
Then use the real armor class, which is your WAS keys. And that's what a monk excels at as well. Now, again, it's a matter of balance through imbalance. And it's just the heavy armor class time to shine. Now, will they change it in a few weeks or a few months and tune it down a little bit? Or maybe when the monk finally gets their love pass, it's going to be out of control again? Of course it's going to be. So it's just a matter of riding the wave out. I pulled some sweet hand wraps today, and I linked them in guild chat, and everyone's like, that had been awesome, except no one plays a monk anymore. And the reason no one plays a monk anymore is because they're not perceived to be good right now, which is totally fine. You can have a good class and you can have a bad class right now at any given moment in time, and that's perfectly fine. You don't have to be able to play every class at every minute, every second of the game, because the people who want to play that class are going to find a way to enjoy that class and have fun and love it.
I'd just like to point out that people do play monks. They just do them as monktures.
They're very powerful right now.
All right, Chai and Axel, you guys got anything to add to this before I ring this bell?
Nah, I'm good.
They've fallen asleep.
I guess kind of what Patrick was touching on, I think the issue is the evasion versus heavy armor thing just, to me, is inherently imbalanced right now because, like I said earlier, the big issue at endgame, or really any point in the game, is spike damage. And even if you have a high dodge on an evasion build, you're still going to take that spike damage. So the real thing that the heavy armor does...
If you're there to get hit.
Well, I mean, you're going to get hit. But if we're talking epically, you're going to get
hit. The philosophy that you're preaching here is don't get hit.
You're going to get hit.
I
mean, you're going to take those giant crits. I mean, the only way you can really reduce that spike damage is through the heavy armor. And you can't really reduce that spike damage through the through the evasion thing. Yeah, you'll take less damage maybe overall, but you're still going to take that huge spike damage.
Or just not be there because you're using your WAS keys because you're so much faster than everybody else, and you're moving in and out of combat when you're supposed to.
There's only one thing in DDO that's more sure than a monk getting hit with a spike damage and getting plastered on the floor. And that's Samus making an inappropriate comment during a podcast to make Lessah laugh.
Well, yeah. Not just in podcasts, everywhere. But the point is, the monk is a skill based on your end. It's your job to play the monk, and it's your job to have the skills for a monk in particular, or any of these currently pajama-wearing builds. Where right now, the way the tanking or the heavy armor stuff works, you don't have to have nearly as much skill. You can rely on your character having the skill, which is a good, fun place to be because it lets these other characters have a time to shine. So let them shine.
That's why we need a big Tarrasque to make tanking a challenge.
Oh, my goodness. The Tarrasque is going to take a dump. Everyone's going to fall over dead going...
That's enough, people. You all bore me. Take 100 XP penalty, everyone. And Axel, Patrick, and Samus, you receive 100 XP for getting down and dirty at the end there. Samus, take an additional 100 XP for saying Drak Blagan repeatedly. And somebody needs to save that character name immediately because it's great. And take an additional 100 XP for talking about blows where it wasn't dirty. Patrick, take your shirt off. Quid pro quo. The struggle is real, or you're not going to win. Just saying.
I took everything off like 3 questions ago.
Okay. Winner of this round is Patrick Shamgar. All right, let's move on to the next things. We're tight on time. What should the necessary XP look like to get to level 30? My God, we're starting with Chai.
Not too much different than it is now, actually. The game is pretty much grindtastic as it is enough where they can kind of smooth everything out at the higher end so that you get levels with slightly less XP so that 29 and 30 can happen without having to move it too much. That being said, I'm not saying don't move it at all, but 29 and 30 don't have to be these... epic exercises and watching the bar move a smidgen every time you run a quest.
Just for clarification, when you say not too much different, you mean that the total XP should more or less be what you need to get to level 30, or the current progression of getting XP should maintain to level 30?
The current amount of XP that you need to get to level 30 should be relatively similar as it is to get to 28 right now.
I thought that's what you meant, but I just wanted to check.
Yeah. See, the first few levels are, like, super easy. You run some Slayers in King's Forest, now you're level 22, or 21, and you run Slayers in a few other zones, and now you're level 22. But when you get to the end, it's like, it starts to move a bit slower. So I think they could smooth some of that out, and maybe add on, like, another million or so XP. But that's pretty easy to get, with people doing dailies and quests that are worth 100,000 and stuff like that, but they don't need to add too much more XP to get 29 and then to get 30 and make it like the slog fest that it could turn into where you run like Epic Wizard King and it moves up like a very little bit and you barely see it move. That'll start getting more grindtastic than it needs to be.
Okay, Samus, go.
I apologize for anyone who wants to edit this show so they don't lose their child-friendly rating, but I've been an opponent that some of these epic levels are bullshit, and I don't think we need level 30, and I don't think there should be anything. And if anything, they should roll back to level 25 and then wait. Because, again, what kind of possibility of any good is there going to be? And then you know they're not going to make this XP a reasonable amount. It's going to be insane. It's going to be the thing that people are going to grind for ages and complain about how DDO is dead. And it doesn't matter. Unless Chai is correct and they like, well, we'll just rebalance things here and there because these levels are bullshit anyway. It's not going to matter because it's just stupid.
Don't sugarcoat it, Samus. Tell us how you really feel. All right, Patrick. Go.
I kept it cleaner.
You did.
I think I'm going to have to get a van because Chai and I are agreeing on too many things today. I would say that it should look fairly similar and probably something. I'd like to see the XP curve for all of epic levels kind of get a pass, not to add XP, but just kind of the standpoint of, I think 20 to 21 is too fast, and currently 27 to 28 is a lot, excessively longer. I don't remember what the numbers are off the top of my head, but I think 20 to 21 is like 300,000 XP, and I think 27 to 28 is like 1 point some odd million. I like to see the numbers even out, because really when it gets down to it, epic levels aren't a lot of... That's not where you're really getting your epic power from. They have an incremental bonus, and for sure, but you know, Destiny is really where that power comes from, so I think we can kind of make those... I'd even be fine if every epic level costs the same amount of XP to get to. I'm not actually saying it should, but I wouldn't have a problem with that.
Okay. Axel, do you have an argument for us?
I don't want to see them increase it too much because we already have enough grind in the game in terms of XP. And I agree with Patrick that I would like to see them rebalance the whole curve because, what, at level 20, 21, it's only like a couple hundred thousand XP. And then you get to the later levels and it's just way more. And another reason is I don't want to see a huge bump in XP because I don't think we're going to have enough content in the 28 to 30 range to support that. It's a little silly to me to have people level 29 running like level 25, 24 stuff because there's just not going to be enough content, at least for a year or so after this cap expansion here.
I just looked it up for information. Getting to level 21 is 300,000 experience from 20 to 21. Going from 27 to 28 is 1.35 million.
Yeah, I'm looking at it too, and it's just ridiculous. It's a huge number that has no real value.
Yeah, and I think if they even those numbers out, it would make the lack of interest of the epic levels a little more or a little less meaningful, if that makes any sense.
I don't want to see them punish people too much who haven't gotten all their ETR lives done, because if they boost, if they make the requirement for ETR and go from 28 to 30, and they add a ton of new extra XP on top of that, some people are going to be upset.
That's what it's going to feel like as well.
They'll be like, man, I should have gotten those lives done when cap was 28.
You can wrap it up now, Lessah. We
okay,
all agree.
Thank
it's
you. Thank you. We all agree. Everybody seems.
Yeah, we're agreeing a lot.
Don't make me pick troll, because I will. All right, there we go. So, Chai, I'm not sure what you said, but it was very diplomatic. 100 XP for you. Samus, 100 XP for not misrepresenting yourself. Patrick, get in the van. Axel, good job. No XP. But good job. You people are agreeing way too much today. All right, last question. What should the new D&D movie be? Casting, basic plots, tagline. It is time for Samus to go first.
Well, casting, I think, is going to be a tough one. But I think the overall idea of the D&D movie is very simple. We have an absolutely amazing module out there in the Eberron, the original Eberron book that came out in 3.5, And they would be perfect. The Last War, or Shadows of the Last War, Grasp of the Emerald, something or other, I forget now, and the Last Titan, whatever it's called. That's an amazing story. It's great. The problem is we really are at risk of having a situation, for those of you who don't know, it is going to be based in Forgotten Realms. And we're going to really be at risk if they pick a too broad of a story, or if they try to cover the entire grasp of Forgotten Realms and really have an issue. Where if they could narrow it down and pick one story and just tell it and tell it well, I think it'll really appeal. The reason I really feel so strongly about Eberron, besides the fact that I think that somebody like Keith Baker could really iron out a script and make it really, really perfect for the big screen, is the fact that people are kind of reaching the point where we're a little burnt out on the fantasy stuff, and we're getting more and more fantasy, where if we could go a little bit more to the steampunk tilt, I think it'll really capture audience and get things growing. And then I think once you have the audience and you have the base going, you could go wide with it. Instead of planning a trilogy that is the Dungeons & Dragons movie, part one, part two, part three of this one epic story we're trying to tell, you could have Dungeons & Dragons Eberron, part one, part two, part three, Dungeons & Dragons Greyhawk, part one, Forgotten Realms, part one, the Drizzt story, blah, blah, blah. And you could set these kind of parallel stories out that they could come out at different times, at different levels. You know, if you want to do something straight to DVD, awesome. You want to go to the big screen, awesome. But you don't want to get in the trap that a lot of people are doing right now with, like, the comic book movies of trying to go too big, too wide, and then they get to a place where the story just falls apart. Keep it short, keep it simple, keep it beautiful.
Ah, Patrick, get on the casting couch. Let's hear what you have to say.
I want a dungeon crawl. I don't want to go save the world. I don't want to go after some evil bad guy. I want a dungeon crawl. I want people to go into a dungeon looking for treasure. No motivation of trying to be goody two-shoes and saving the world. Maybe something kind of like a heist-ish kind of movie, but in a dungeon kind of thing. What I'm thinking for cast is Peter Dinklage as a halfling barbarian. Ronda Rousey as a half-orc fighter, Vin Diesel as a monk, maybe Zoe Saldana as kind of a battle cleric, like heal-yourself kind of attitude, a lot of sass. Sean Bean as a wizard, because someone needs to die, and someone needs to die early, and kind of make it real and dangerous, and no one dies better in movies than Sean Bean. And then we need a rogue, and I'm thinking someone to be a little geeky, a little bumbling, and I'm going with Grant Gustin.
You're looking at my ass, Brian.
I want to know why the wizard's got to die. That doesn't make any sense.
I kind of gave him wizard as a different class, because I'm trying to get a good representation of different classes, a good mix of men and women. And by the way, if you don't know who Grant Gustin is, that's the guy who plays the Flash on the TV series.
I see. Go into the judge. Real quickly before we go off of the judge, I want to say
that is
everybody
pandering.
Else that she wants so the redhead from Buffy and everybody else too. I want to get all those bonus points for pandering. All right, continue.
Okay, Axel, let's hear about your movie.
Well, when I heard about the movie that was being made, like, the immediate idea I had was, let's have the movie, you start out, you have a group of friends sitting around a table playing tabletop D&D, and as the movie goes on, you kind of see the story and the adventure that's going on in real life switch back and forth. So as they're telling the story, you see it acted out, of course, with the actors and such, and then it would switch back also to real day, real time. So it would just keep switching back and forth. You see the adventure that's going on in their heads, going on the movie screen. As far as casting, I think I would prefer unknowns, actually. Just so there's no typecasting going on. But if I had to pick some celebrities, I guess I would. I think like Mila Jovovich would be a good rogue. Gerard Butler would be a good paladin. Maybe the barbarian. Maybe have the Rock.
Can we afford him? I'm not sure. All right, Chai, let's hear it.
Wait, before he goes, I forgot my tagline. My tagline for this movie is "Never split the party."
Okay, Chai, go.
The dungeon crawl, huh? I think they should tell the Danilo Thon story. It's more adult-oriented than most of the Dungeons & Dragons fiction that was written. So they would either need to, A, go off the rails and tell a more adult story rather than go with most of the stuff that's in the books, or they would have to pick one of the very few stories that are more adult-oriented. The Danilo-thon story is great because it's not like the most popular part of the fiction, but it's still like he encounters a lot of different people in a lot of their books as well as Erlen. The romance is there. The actual killing and people not coming back is there. Main characters or semi-main characters dying is there. So you don't necessarily have, you know, the whole safe, we're going to make it, the 11th hour rescue type plot. You get to see Waterdeep, the huge city that it is, and how much people use magic in it, which is one of the more popular settings in Dungeons & Dragons. You'll get to see the Harpers, which are one of the more popular groups in Dungeons & Dragons. As far as casting, I have no flippin' idea. I would rather probably go with unknowns for the same reason, so that people wouldn't be typecast, or people that were previously typecast wouldn't be like, oh, the guy that played this is now playing that character in the D&D movie. But I think that story, it has it all. It has the death meaning something. It has the actual romance. It has adventure. It has reasons for why people are evil and not just I kill people because I'm evil and therefore you need to stop me because I'm the villain. The villains are very not Disney. They're definitely developed characters in and of their own right. And sometimes Danilo has to work with the villains in order to achieve his goals and vice versa. So it's definitely more adult material, and I think it would make a better movie than most D&D fiction would.
All right, you guys want to argue this out any, or shall I wrap this thing?
I think you should call it.
Okay,
well, hang on, real fast. Oh. I just want to say that if you want to see Axel's movie, it's called The Gamers, and you can see that over at deadgentleman.com. They actually have a whole bunch of them. So if you want to watch his movie, that's where it is.
Well, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, right? All right, Samus, 500 XP for your pitch, because I'm not exactly sure I remember what it was. Patrick, I don't think we can afford Sean Bean, and Grant Gustin is way too busy with his flash shooting schedule. There's just no way he could fit this in.
TV and movies.
So what we really, and they're too expensive anyway, so what we really need are clones of these guys, you know, lookalikes. And I'm going to give you 10,000 XP for mentioning my favorite actor. Thank you very much. That was very, very cleverly done. Well played.
I told you I wasn't
played. All right, Axel, 500 XP for your pitch 2. I'm going to go check out Dead Gentleman Projects Gamer Series, yada, yada, yada. And Chai, 1,000 XP for pitching a more adult storyline, and an additional 500 XP for talking about Waterdeep, because that's the city that I most, or the place I most remember whenever I think about the books. Evil people are evil for a reason, right? Who doesn't love a good bad guy? All right, I think the winner here is going to be Patrick, because I awarded him so much XP at the end. Good job, Patrick! What did I tell you, Samus? Before we even came in.
I knew.
You knew.
It's fun. All I know is if we had a straw poll, I'm pretty sure it'd be pretty clearly yours truly.
All right, I relinquish all of my power. I'm drunk with it now, Patrick, so you need to take it back anyway.
Thanks, guys, for helping out with the show. It was a great show, a little long, so I'm going to wrap this up pretty quick because I got another show to do. Do we double feature? I am. This show will be out this weekend.
Nice.
So just some last calls quickly before we go. PAX Prime is August 28th through the 31st. There will be a get-together at the Rock Bottom Brewery on 5th Avenue in Seattle on Friday the 28th at 9 p.m. We'll be there until we have a party wipe, so please come and join there. I'm going to do some quick plugs for folks here. Samius Gurobo, at Samius Gurobo on Twitter. You can also catch him on Cocktail Hour and Talk Tiny to Me, I believe is the name of your other podcast.
Correct.
Axel DDO has got a YouTube channel. It's got a nice variety of some stuff that I'm playing and some kind of commentary stuff. Anything else you want to say about it?
Not really. I think you got it. Great. Yeah, it's mostly commentary, a little bit of gameplay, a little bit of strategy stuff. But yeah, the focus of the channel is mainly commentary.
If you're looking for it, if you go to the DDOCast YouTube page, it should be linked there as well. Chai from the Supply and Permadeath Guild, and one of the apparently most controversial persons on the forums, amongst other things. You can catch him also on DDO Kasplat with me and Lessah, who is also on Cocktail Hour, of course, and Damsels of DDO. And I'm guessing there should be an episode coming out soon.
Yes, you're guessing correctly.
So, anything else anyone wants to name drop here? Excellent. So thanks for listening to the show, and thanks to all these fine folks for debating some of the bigger topics in the kind of DDO world right now. And thanks to other cast contributors as well. And thanks to Turbine and Wizards and Cyberears for hosting the podcast. You can hit us up at DDOCast.com for show notes, our calendar, previous shows, swag, and other fun stuff. If you'd like to be part of the show, if you have a comment on this episode, you have a question you'd like us to ask or to answer, or a topic you'd like us to debate, or if you just want to say hi, you can leave a comment, or you can email us at DDOCast@gmail.com. You can also find us on social media and send us that stuff there at DDOCast. The closing tip for the week, wait until everyone is done shrining before casting buffs on the party. And so with that...
I figured out a tagline while you're talking for my movie. Magic is technology, Eberron.
Nice. So until next time, may all your trackles be crits, all your chests level appropriate, have fun, and don't forget to check out all these fine folks and what they're doing and all their endeavors in DDO and everyone else.